हेलो फ्रेंड्स, टुडे वी विल डिस्कस समथिंग अबाउट स्टेट एस्टिमेशन। लर्निंग ऑब्जेक्टिव्स ऑफ दिस टॉपिक्स आर, आफ्टर डिस्कशिंग स्टेट एस्टिमेशन वी विल रियलाइज द इम्पोर्टेंस ऑफ स्टेट एस्टिमेशन ऑफ इलेक्ट्रिकल पावर नेटवर्क एंड रिकॉग्नाइज द क्वांटिटीज रिक्वायर टू बी मेजर फॉर इट्स इवेल्यूएशन। सेकेंडली we will study the layout of centralized data acquisition system where the data from the real field are acquired and they are used to estimate the states and getting the correct value. Then after we will understand and apply the statistical technique of weighted leak estimation for estimating the power system variables. Afterwards we will define and differentiate the importance of few statistical terms like state variables, what is measurement variables, what is redundancy and what is the noise and how they can be defined mathematically, as well as we will elaborate in detail. Afterwards we will realize the limitations of state estimation power flow in power system and reproduce the state estimation model to make it more comfortable and more easy to understand as well as more accurate. We will also understand the Gaussian probability density function. And last one, that is, we will develop the skill to utilize this mathematical tool, which I have mentioned earlier, to identify the entry and treatment for bad data and arrive the suitable estimation, which is almost accurate. As I mentioned earlier, the outline of my presentation, that is, first we will discuss the need of state estimation, followed by an introduction. Then after we will discuss few useful definition, because we are going to use that term on a regular basis afterwards. Then after we will discuss the layout. After discussing layout, we will discuss least square estimation technique, which is widely used for the state estimation. And then after, how we will use the state estimator in power system network when we have only measurement of V and delta, as well as PQ measurement, how these two cases are widely vary with each other, we will also discuss. And bad data identification and treatment, that will be also carried out. So first we will discuss the need of state estimation, why we are doing state estimation in power system. So first one, that is, it will provide the real time database for online security analysis. Suppose my system is vulnerable for some perturbation or it is about to collapse, then whether the acquire value or measure value will be correct or not, that I don't know. So at that point of time, I require some reliable results which are based on calculation. And I can say that these are almost true value and we can totally rely on this. Accordingly, the decision will be taken and security constraint can be fulfilled. Second one, that is, it will provide the facilitator of real-time flow for the optimization. Suppose if I want to have a use of optimized power flow, then the accurate value is needed. And this state estimation enable us to have this accurate value. Third one, that is, I built an excellent number of control, dispatch and record keeping function by improving the quality of data. Sometimes we know that the measurement of data is not so accurate, sometimes due to instrument error, sometimes due to human error, sometimes due to the error of parallax. So there are many contributors due to which the data which is measured from the real field are not accurate. So if we take any decision based on that data, then our decision may reflect on a adverse side. So in order to rectify this issue, it is required to have a calculated value. This calculated value is almost treated as a true value from this measured variable. And after derive this true value, we can make our concrete decision. So these are the need of state estimation, that by estimating the state, we will almost derive the true value of that state variable, and this will enable us to make a power system on a more healthy side. Basically, what is state estimation? Now let me define state estimation. State estimation is defined as a process to identify the correct value of the state by minimizing the error. Means, initially suppose we have some measure value. From that measure value, how we can derive the true value, that entire process is known as a state estimation. In order to achieve this higher degree of accuracy, two modifications are required. First one, that is, numerical value of data processed for the state estimation are generally noise, So error are preserved, that we have to understand. And second one, there are very large number of variables such as P, active power, Q, reactive power, VA, that is apparent power, VAR, once again, it is a reactive power, and line flows, which can be measured by multiple variables or multiple instruments, but they are not utilized for load flow analysis. So sometimes it is a choice on a person to person that will be changed. That if we have n number of equations and we have only few, suppose we have 20 equations and we have only 5 variables which are going to determine its value. So we can collect any 5 out of 20 to solve that equation. So it is up to a person who is carry out that calculation, that which 5 equations they have to select. And that is also a one kind of issue so far state estimation is concerned. We will discuss this later on. And we will also derive that how we can calculate that the best estimation or the best equations which we should use for the calculation. Therefore, the process of state estimation involves imperfect measurement, which are very reluctant. Reluctance means a kind of data which includes some noise or some inaccurate results, which may gives us a wrong result. Suppose if we take a result of ammeter, which going to measure at 2 ampere current, if 2 volt source is connected with 1 ohm, then the result will be unanimous. That should be a 2 ampere. But meter will may show 1.99, 1.98. It may show 2.05. So due to this error, if we calculate, then if we apply V by R is equals to I, then this equation as well as the measured value, which is showing by that ammeter, will not match. Hence, if we calculate the value of V, then the actual value as well as the calculated value may have a mismatch. So at that point of time, we have to apply certain technique by which we can improve the accuracy or we can find out the true value by minimizing the error. So that is complete thing which we are going to discuss while discussing the process of state estimation. We are commonly familiar with the minimizing least of square, that is only also a aspect of mathematical, but we will discuss that technique also. Hence, we can enable students to have a practice that technique on a simple circuit, and afterwards we will proceed to apply the same technique on a power system. Basically, state estimation can be classified by two ways. First one is static and second one is dynamic. We will discuss only static estimation right now. In power system, state variables are the voltage, magnitudes, and the relative phase angles. Suppose after that PMU, now the clocks are synchronized, but we have n number of variables or n number of instruments which are locating on the same room. And if we collect the results out of them, then one result will be taken at time t 1 second, second result will be taken at time t 2 seconds, then it may create a mismatch due to the time constraint. It is not possible for a human to collect all the values on the same time. So what exactly PMU will do? PMU is doing by synchronizing clock, they will match the clock evenly. Hence, whatever the reading which is reflected at x second, that same x second will be considered for all the readings. So when we have a chart or we will have a data, that moment that will be reflected for a same instrument on a same side or for a different instrument for a same instant. So suppose I am taking a reading for 10 o'clock, it means that whether it will be instrument 1 or instrument 5, if PMU will be located, then same result will be reflected and time will be synchronized. So this is the main benefit after installation of PMU, that we have synchronized the clock. Hence, the value of variable at a particular instant will not alter. Otherwise, if we consider a human who are going to take a reading of several meters, it may not happen for a human, or it is not possible for a human to collect all the data on a particular instant. So basically, they are used for a system security and economic constraint, as I mentioned earlier. Now, we will discuss some definitions. These definitions are useful because now onwards we will use that technical terms which we are going to define. and based on the technical words, we will proceed. So first one, that is state variables. What is state variables? State variables are defined as a set of non-superfluous variable which completely illustrate the operation or state of a system. Suppose whether my system is going to be or whether my any bus of a particular system will be vulnerable or weak bus. For that, if I calculate that value, then it should not be a superfluous value, but it will show me the exact value. V and delta of that particular bus should be calculated or should be treated as a true value. So normally in power system, V and delta are considered as a state variables. So by identifying the state variables, we can judge the system more correctly or the operation of the system more correctly. Second, measurement variable. As name itself suggests, that the instrument which are going to measure any quantity, they all variables are known as a measured variable. So measure variables are nothing but the quantity which is measured by instrument or measurable devices. Redundancy, this is a technical term, but may student will come across many times because they have also learned instrumentation. So redundancy is the difference between measured variable and state variables. Suppose we have m number of measured variables and n number of state variables, then we can say that the redundancy is m minus n. It is also known as a degree of freedom. Now, I like to bring your kind attention. Suppose I have a measure variables 5 and I have only 2 state variables, means I have only 2 buses, but I have installed 5 instrument to measure some value, suppose say current, voltage, or say voltage drop or that kind of thing. So by using 5 instrument, I am going to derive the value of only 2 state variables. So now my unknowns are state variables, they are 2, but the measurement variables, they are 5. So now out of that 5, I require only 2 readings to justify that equation or to solve that equation. So out of that 5, which 2 will be selected, which will gives me the more accurate result, that will be the thing which we are going to discuss in state estimation. Next one is redundancy factor. Redundancy factor is a ratio of number of measurement variables to number of state variables. It is nothing but m divided by n. And noise. Noise is always an unwanted disturbances. So noise is defined as an unwanted disturbance or signals which encounter during the measurement of physical quantity. So from now onwards, we will only talk about state variables, measurement variables, redundancy and noise. So now we will not tell or we will not speak about V, delta, that kind of thing. We will only talk about state variables. If some measurement will be there, we will treat them as a measured variable, like P, Q and other part. Okay, so from now onwards, we will use these two technical terms more frequently. First one, that is state variables, and second one is measurement variable. Now, many times it is going to ask what is the difference between state variables and load flow. So basically in load flow cases, we are analyzing bus voltage, magnitude and angles by processing the available data network. Over here, we are using that data, but our motive is to find out the true value. In load flow, we are only calculating the things which are static in nature because it is also known as a static power flow. So it is nothing but the snapshot of that network which are using, and based on calculation of active and reactive power flow, we will find out the weak bus and strong bus of that network. In case of state estimation, that is not the case. Over here, we want to find out the true value. Whether after first iteration, we can determine the true value or after third iteration, that is a matter of significance in state estimation, which is not true for load flow studies. Next one is, in load flow study, main motive is to identify the weak bus during the change of load. Suppose if the path will be diverted, then which bus will be affected more or which one may violate the limit of voltage stability. That is our main motive. While in state estimation, minimization of error or to find out the true value, that will be a main motive. Load flow study, it provides the data about system stability, while state estimation will provide a data about detection of inconsistency error in measurement instruments. In load flow studies, voltage magnitude and angles are calculated at every buses. Over here, the state variables which we have defined, they are only going to calculate. Suppose we have two buses, then it is not possible for n number of buses where we are going to calculate. If we are only going to frame a equation for two buses, then estimation of that state variables that will be done only for two buses. We are not going to go for a calculation or carried out our calculation for n number of buses. In load flow, number of equation based on number of measured variable, as I previously mentioned, if we have m number of state variables, then we have m number of equations. But we have n number of state variables, then we require only n number of equation where n is less than m. Okay. While for all the buses, that is not the case with load flow studies. Load flow studies, for each bus, we required the equation. The concept of redundancy, noise, bed data, waiting factor is not going to discuss in load flow studies, where over here we have to take care about all these criteria or all these parameters such as redundancy, noise, bed data, waiting factor, as well as our motive is to minimize that error. So how we can reduce these factors, that will be also a matter of concern for state estimation. Over here in load flow study, the concept of slack bus or load or the loss at the end of load flow study, we will allocate our all the losses to the slack bus. Over here, slack bus is required, but it is not for that purpose, that when at the end of state estimation, all the losses, because losses are not the prime concern. Over here, the prime motive is to find out correct value. So though slack bus is defined, but the motive of slack bus is not for a loss allocation or that kind of thing. It is only that the value of that bus that will be fixed. We are not going to calculate V and delta for that slack bus in state estimation. However, by treating that as a constant for other buses, we are going to calculate the V and delta. And our motive is, as I mentioned earlier, it is to find out the exit value or true value for other buses. Keep this thing in mind that for state estimation, once we define the slack bus, then the calculation for V and delta, for the exact value of V and delta, are not going to carry out. This is the functional block diagram. In functional block diagram, our measure variable are the input for static state estimation. And what are the measurement? Measurements are in terms of active power, reactive power, and V apparent power. And errors should be minimized by using any technique. And what are the output? Output is nothing but the state variables. These state variables will provide us a data to judge security constraint, as well as we can take application in economical dispatch or optimal power flow. This is nothing but the main layout of our data acquisition system. Centralized data acquisition system, many RTU, that is remote RTU, stands for remote terminal unit. So number of RTUs are placed in a real field. From that RTU, data are acquired by a central buffer, and then after this data is processed. After processing the data, over here the calculations are carried out by a mainframe computer or in a real-time data that will be evaluated. This data are stored. See, this data is stored for a multiple purpose. Suppose we require some historical data to replace some data, then that stored data can be used. Second one, for load forecasting, we require the data of the previous year. So that data is also available. Sometimes in security constraint, we require for historical data. So that will be also utilized. So the storage of data is basically a kind of data storage by which we can collect some historical data when and while required. Data manager, this is the most important feature of this. This database manager that will provide human interference machine, because if we want to apply some technique, then we require this block. CRT display. CRT display will have two options. First one, it will show the measured value. as well as after calculation, it will show you the correct value. So to display that value or to display that output, we require the CRT display. Data logs, they will separately log out flue value. They will provide the logistic management. Suppose V and delta at a particular time, you can notify as well as record it by using this data log. Automatic generation control, as we have already studied AGC. So the variation in frequency as well as variation in delta V, terminal voltage, that will be also recorded using AGC, as well as some decisions, important decisions are taken to remove the large frequency variation and large voltage variation. Alarm, if the system is going to have some abnormal things, then provision of alarm is also there. Task scheduler is there. Suppose we want to carry out some task in future, then we can plan this task by using this task scheduler. An editor is that editor that we can edit any program or any kind of event by using this editor. Suppose task is set for 1st of December, we want to reschedule it on a 1st of Jan, then by using this editor, we can also schedule our task manager accordingly. Now, let us discuss least square estimation. It is a kind of thing or havoc is created. What is least square estimation? So let it define on a stepwise, and we will proceed very gradually, that each of you or every student should understand the concept of least square estimation thoroughly. So over here, we are going to discuss only three terms. First one is Zm, second one is Zc, and third one is zeta. What is Zm? Zm is nothing but measurement variable or measured value. Any instrument which is located in the field that will show or reveal any value, that will be nothing but the measured value. But as we know that there is a difference between true value or correct value and measured value. That difference is nothing but the error. So Zc, that will provide the calculated value or true value, and that will be calculated by using H product of H and X, where H, that will be the coefficient of matrix, H matrix, and this matrix is derived based on the network topology of the power system, where X is nothing but your state variables. Zeta, as I mentioned earlier, it is nothing but the error. So therefore, we can write that if we replace Zc by Hx, now measured variable is nothing but the addition of Hx plus zeta. So now let's discuss the size of matrix, because many of you may have a confusion because all the calculations are carried out in matrix or by supercomputer. So the matrix dimensions are the prime important things, because many times we have a mismatch in matrix, hence the calculation will not proceed further. So in order to minimize that error, let us discuss the size of the matrix which we are going to deal with. So Zm, if number of variables are m and number of state variables are n, then the size of Zm, it is obvious, it is m cross 1. H matrix, that size will be m cross n. M stands for measurement variable and n stands for state variables. What is X? X is nothing but state variables, so it is a column matrix and its size is n cross 1, where error is nothing but each instrument will have some error in its measurement, hence its size will be same as the size of Zm. So it is m cross 1. Now using this equation, we can also write that error is equals to Zm minus Hx. If we shift this zeta on the right hand side and bring this on this side, then we will have this equation. Similarly, we can write that after first iteration, that the expected value of error should be H of X hat over hat. This parameters, you should keep this thing in mind, that X, this is known as a X hat. Okay, so X hat is nothing but the expected value. So after first calculation, the value of X which is going to change, it is known as a expected value. Expected value of error, that should be zero, because we want to minimize it, and the minimum value of error, that will be zero. So whenever any variable will be represented by its hat's value, it means that that will represent a expected value. Now, weighted leg square estimation technique is used for the minimization of error. So how we can proceed further? So in that, if we want to have a know the accuracy of offer by any meters, so according to that, the weightage will be given. Suppose if my instrument is 100% okay, then its weightage will be 100%. But if the instrument is accurate, it doesn't mean that the indicated value that will be also true, because sometimes due to the human error, some error may be introduced while we are collecting the readings. So by using that technique, each and every meter will be provide a weighting factor. So now the minimization function for least square estimation is defined as, it is a nothing but from 1 to n number of variables into wi into zeta I square. Zeta I is nothing but the error offered by ith instrument, and wi is nothing but the weighting factor of that ith instrument. In some good books, if you refer good books, then calculation of weighting factor is also given by an empirical formula. Empirical formula is something, the formula which is derived by experience. So some expert of field have determined this formula, and based on this formula, we can calculate the weighting factor of any instrument. And that formula to calculate the weighting factor is 50 into 10 raised to minus 6 divided by C1 into SI plus C2 into FSD whole square, where C1 and C2, they are constant. And their values are normally C1 will lie from 0.001 to 0.002, whereas C2 will lie from 0.0025 to 0.005. SI, that will stand for absolute value of ith measurement. Suppose I have a measurement of instrument 1, then SI, that will be the reading of that ith measurement. And FSD, that is a full scale deflection of that instrument. Now we want to minimize this function. So we have already studied in maths that the first order partial derivative will give us the condition, and if second order derivative will provide us a positive sign, then the dy by dx, that will be the condition, or first order partial derivative provides us the condition for minima. But if second order derivative, that will be offers a negative sign, then first order partial derivative will give us the condition for maxima. So over here, our function is f is equals to sigma 1 to I to m and omega I into zeta I square. So over here, d phi by dx, if we calculate, should be 0. Then if we take the first order partial derivative, we have this equation. If we take d square f by dx square, then that will be positive. Hence, this will be the condition for minima. If we proceed further, then we can easily write that df by dx1, because I is going to change. Suppose if I am talking for the first state estimator or first state variables, then now my equation will be 2 into bracket w1, that is weighting factor for instrument 1, zeta 1, that is error shown by my meter 1, and first meter error with respect to my state variables, that is the first order partial derivative, and so on up to mth. Suppose if I have m number of variables, then the row column will be from 1 to m. Now for second state variables, same thing will be repeated, and for mth variable I have repeated the same thing. Over here I have considered that I have m number of state variables and m number of measured variables. In most of the problem, we will see that the number of state variables are very less compared to number of measurement variables. Now, if we consider this and separate out this column, now we can easily derive this, that the first matrix will nothing but the partial order derivative of error to the state variables. Second, that will be a diagonal matrix which shows only weighting factor. And third one, that is nothing but your error or column matrix which shows only error. So what I did over here, I have separated out this equation and form in a matrix. So separate three matrix are shown and all are in multiplication with each other. So now, as I mentioned earlier, notation of x hat that shows the estimated vector, the value of estimated vector can be replaced by actual vector. So I can say that over here, this is my H matrix. This is known, first order partial derivative matrix is known as a H matrix. This is matrix of my weighting factor where only diagonal elements remain present. And third matrix, that will be the error matrix. So I can write a normal equation in matrix form, that is H transpose omega into, sorry, H transpose W into zeta should be equals to zero, where H, that is nothing but the formation of partial derivative matrix. This is weighting matrix, which is diagonal. And this is column matrix, which is known by zeta. So if we proceed further, then we can also write that H transpose W into zeta should be equals to H transpose W into ZM minus HX, because as we already defined that zeta is error, and error is nothing but it is a subtraction of measured value minus true value. So from measured value and true value, we can derive that H transpose W into ZM should be equals to H transpose W into HX. If we once again go and calculate that term, we can also get that the first state variable should be equals to G inverse H into W into ZM, where G inverse is H transpose W into H. So this is nothing but the simple calculation. By using this calculation, you can derive that to, in order to find out the value of state variable, you have to calculate G inverse. Once you find G inverse, which is equals to H transpose W into H, it should be multiplied with, once again, with H matrix, W matrix and ZM, and that will give you the matrix of X. So if you have two state variables, then matrix of X, that will be 2×1. If you have n number of state variables, the matrix of X, that will be n×1. Now, so far theory part is concerned. Basically, if you discuss theory n number of times, and at the end of session, I have found many students don't know anything about it. So it is always better to discuss the numericals on which the same theory can be applied, and hence student can easily understand that concept also. So we are going to proceed in the same line, that this is measurement which is recorded by my Z1 to Z5, and the value for Z1 to Z5 are Z1 is equals to 2 ampere, Z2 is equals to minus 0.25 ampere, Z3 is equals to 1.2 ampere, Z4 is equals to 11 volt, and Z5 is equals to minus 1 volt. Consider over here, the weighting factor is already given, that for first and second, they are 100% accurate meters, means Z1 and Z2, both ammeters are 100% accurate, while 3, 4 and 5 means this third instrument, fourth instrument and fifth instrument, they are 70% accurate. Over here, we have two voltage sources, hence we have two state variables and measurement variables. We have five measurement, hence number of measurement variables are five. So in this case, n is equals to 2 and m is equals to 5. So now the biggest problem is, we know the equation that x is equals to g inverse into h into w into zm. Zm vector is known to us because z1 to z5 is given. But how to calculate G, and to, in order to find out G inverse, first we have to make the matrix of H. So H matrix can be find out by applying superposition theorem. In superposition theorem, what exactly we are going to do is, initially we will consider voltage V1. V1 is equals to 1 volt and V2, that will be short circuited. And now we will note down the readings which is offered by from Z1 to Z5. So over here, from Z1 to Z5, that will give us the elements of Z matrix. So then after, in case 2, we are again applying superposition theorem, considering V2, where V2 is equals to 1 volt and V1 should be short circuited or it is equals to 0. Once again, we will find out the value offered by Z1 to Z5. and that will gives us another elements of H matrix. So now we are carried out our calculation by using some superposition theorem. As I mentioned earlier, case 1 we are considering that V1 is equals to 1 volt and V2 is short circuited. Now the equivalent resistance, if we determine by considering V1 only from this circuit, so it will be 2 ohm resistance, which is in series with the parallel combination of 6 ohm and 4 ohm. So total 6 and 4, they are in parallel. So 6 cross 4 divided by 6 plus 4. So 6, 4, that is 24 divided by 10. So that is 2.4, which is added into 2. So lump sum, that will be 4.4. Now, by application of 1 volt, we can find out the reading for Z1, Z2, Z3 and Z4. And they are, for Z1, emitter, that is 0.2273. For Z2, it is minus 0.1364. And for Z3, it is 0.0909 ampere. Now, Z4 and Z5, they are voltmeter. So once we know the current flowing through that resistance of 6 ohm and 4 ohm, we have to only do the multiplication of I into R. So I, that is current, which is 0.909 into 6, that is the current flowing through 6 ohm resistance. And in order to find out the voltage across 6 ohm resistance, it is simple as Ohm's law, product of I and R. So the value for Z4, it is 0.5455. Same, the value for Z5, it is 0.5455. If we apply simple basic principle of electricity, then if two circuits are in parallel, then voltage across both the elements should remain equal. And that will be also verified that both Z4 and Z5 both have a same value, which is equals to 0.5455. Now, all the students, now see this, that H11 is nothing but your Z1. What is first element of your H matrix? First row and first column element of your H matrix is equals to Z1 after application of superposition theorem. Second row, first element. Now, if we consider the size of H matrix, that will be M cross N. What is M? In this, M is equals to 5 and N is equals to 2. So the size of H matrix, that is 5 cross 2, means it has 5 rows and 2 columns. So after application of superposition theorem in case 1, we will obtain first column. In first column, we have 5 rows. And these 5 rows are nothing but the readings of Z1 to Z5. So over here, we are putting the same value, then H11 is equals to Z1. It is equals to 0.2273. H22 is equals to minus 0.1364. H31 is equals to 0.909. H41, that is fourth row and first column, that element's value will be nothing equals to Z4. It is minus 0.5455. And similarly, H51 is equals to minus 0.5455. Over here, as it is a DC circuit, then positive and negative polarity is mandatory to assign. And that's why some of the readings or some of the H element is placed with the negative sign. Now let's move further and consider the case 2 for superposition theorem. For case 2, what we are going to do, that here we have placed V2 is equals to 1 volt and V1 is short circuited. Now we are repeating the same thing. Now we will find the equivalent resistance. Now consider the circuit. If we have V2 over here and V1 is short circuited, then we have to look this circuit from this side. So at that point of time, 4 ohm resistance will be in series with the combination of 2 ohm and 6 ohm. Both are in parallel. So 6 2s are 12 divided by 8 plus 4. So now our combination will be 4 plus 6 into 2 divided by 6 plus 2. Hence, our equivalent will be 5.5. Now, if we apply simple KVL and KCL, we can find out the value of the measurement from Z1 to Z5. So Z2 over here, it is 1 divided by 5.5. It is 0.1818. For Z1, it is equals to minus 1364. Minus sign is a nothing but the polarity, which indicates that this calculated current flow in the opposite direction which we have connected. For Z3, it is 0.0455. Once again, as I explained earlier, Z4 and Z5, they are nothing but the voltmeter. Hence, over here, Z4 is 0.4555 and Z5 is 0.7273. Now, if we calculate the second column component of H matrix, then first one, that is H21, is equals to Z1, that is minus 1364, as we calculated earlier. H22, second row and second column, that is Z2. We have already calculated Z2 is equals to 0.1818. H32 is equals to 0.0455, which is equals to Z3. And Z4 and Z5, that will give you the value of H coefficient, H42 and H52. If we substitute this value, then we can easily form H matrix. Now the calculations are very easy, as we know that G is nothing but G is equals to H transpose W into H. H matrix is already formed, so we can easily find out H transpose. W is diagonal matrix, weighting factor is already known. So first two, W1 and W2 is 100, W3, W4 and W5, they are 75, rest of the components are 0. And what is this? It is nothing but the H. So if we substitute the value of H transpose W into H, we will have 2 cross 2 matrix of G. Now X hat is equals to G inverse H transpose W into H. So if we substitute this value over here, we can find out the value V1 and V2, which is equals to 15.0034 and 9.9027. Over here, it is a simple DC circuit and we are only concerned with the magnitude. So how we can apply state estimation, weighted least square estimation using DC circuit or simple electrical circuit that we have calculated. Okay, so after discussing this numerical, I hope that all of you will be able to understand the use of state estimation in solving the problem of electrical network. In next session, we will discuss about how this can be utilized further for the power system. Thank you.